Welcome to Sunday Night Prime. I'm Father Andrew Apostoli, member of the Franciscan Friars of the Renewal, and I'm happy to be your host for tonight's very interesting program. Before we get into it, I'd like to mention, if you have any questions or comments or even suggestions for themes that you'd like to see programs here on Sunday Night Prime, please send us your emails. Send them to sundaynightprime@ewtn.com. I'll repeat that, sundaynightprime@ewtn.com. Well, you know, the future of our church and even our nation depends on our young people. And you know, they are the church of tomorrow. I remember when Pope John Paul II finished his studies in Rome and came back to Poland, which was then under the communist leadership. The primate of Poland at the time, Cardinal Wyszyński, told him, he said, you know, we have to reach the youth because the communists are going to try to reach them. And the future of our faith in Poland depends on reaching them. And that's why he dedicated so much of his time and his efforts to work with young people. He knew the importance of doing that. And our young people today are facing great struggles to remain faithful to their Catholic faith. And so those who work with them, you know, are doing a great mission, in particularly in this time when we speak of the new evangelization in the church. And so we're very happy tonight to have as our special guest someone who is deeply involved in the work with young adults, the future of our church. And I'd like to welcome as our special guest tonight, Colin Nykaza.
Yes.
Who is the Director of Young Adult Ministry for the Archdiocese of New York.
Yes, thank you so much for having me. I'm excited to be here.
It's a privilege and an honor to have you on the program today because, you know, you're, as I mentioned in this little introduction, you're doing wonderful work, work that has to be done. And we've chosen for the theme, or I want to say that Colin asked for this theme, what do you seek? The journey of a restless heart. And so many of our young people are restless, aren't they?
They are. They are.
Colin, you know, how did you, you know, first get in, you know, into a little bit of your background? I don't.
Sure.
Maybe some of the New Yorkers know you, but around the country they're going to want to know, and around the world too. Tell us a little bit about yourself, your background.
Well, let me start off by saying that the reason I kind of chose this theme in the sense is that, you know, from a very early age, early on in my life, I always had this ache. Even I remember as early as fifth grade on, you know, looking for something. I was always looking for love or intimacy or some type of union and communion. And it kind of fits out throughout my whole life. So, you know, I kind of grew up cradle Catholic with my family. My parents were really good about getting us to Mass every Sunday and grace before meals. But, you know, throughout, especially in high school, I was doing a lot of the same stuff that my friends were doing, which was not really good stuff and a lot of unhealthy stuff. And so I wasn't always the best example. And, you know, it kind of fits into the theme in the sense that, you know, it was funny, even in the sense of the dating world, I know in the sense that when you're in middle school and high school, it's like you could be dating, but it's not necessarily real dating. But I felt like when I was a child, I was kind of like the Mac Daddy in the sense of with the women. It was very interesting. Like, you know, early on, like in fifth grade, I kind of had a girlfriend. And even in fifth grade, I started to, in a sense, kind of date older women. And I was dating like sixth graders, you know, and I know it's not real dating. But but even then, I was really like searching for the, you know, for love, especially with the opposite sex. And it kind of was really deep for me in the sense that at times, you know, in early on, I was able to, was looking for, like achieving what I was kind of looking for. But at the same time, then middle school hit and my body started to change a little bit. I started to gain a little bit of weight. And I noticed that girls, in a sense, were kind of responding to that in the sense that I wasn't able to date as much as I was looking for. I just wanted that girlfriend. Like if I was at a dance, I was too embarrassed to go ask that girl out and stuff. And then in high school, it came to the point where, you know, my body type started to change again. I started to slim down and I was lifting weights. And then the girl started responding again. So it was interesting that I kind of associated, like, with my ache that I had to look a certain way or be a certain body type to find what I was looking for in the sense of relationships, in the sense of love. Mm-hmm. And it was difficult because even in middle school, I felt that rejection very deeply, you know. And then it came to a point where I was a sophomore year of college And I started to, just kind of on a personal of like, you know, again, the ache and why this was so important to me, I started to lose my hair a little bit. And I also started to gain a little bit of weight. And I was devastated. I thought that this was it. I'm not going to be able to find the love that I was looking for. And I didn't feel like I was lovable. And I'm not saying that everybody can relate to that necessarily in the sense of, you know, not everybody goes through the same thing, but I think we can all relate to the fact that a lot of us in different times of our life, we don't feel lovable. And this was the exact moment mm-hmm. when I had a very powerful encounter with the Blessed Virgin Mary. And basically what ended up happening was I was reading about Our Lady of Fatima, and this is again sophomore year of college, and I found this book in my parents' drawer about the apparitions of Our Lady. So I was reading about different of the apparitions, but finally Fatima came, and it was the quote that Our Lady said to Lucia when she asked Lucia if the children would be willing to suffer for the conversion and for reparation for sins against the Immaculate, you know, against mm-hmm. the Immaculate Heart.
Yep.
And right at that moment, I just felt this very powerful love just penetrate throughout my whole body. It's almost like if Our Lady was pouring her love into me. I don't remember if it started from my head to my feet or feet up, but I just never felt so loved during that encounter by Our Lady. And same type of thing, during that summer, I went to Padre Pio's canonization and I had a similar experience in the sense of during the consecration of the host, you know, during the Mass. Yeah. Right at that moment, I felt this penetrating of life and love just kind of go through my whole being. And the reason why I share all of that is that I just noticed that at that very moment when I thought that I was not lovable and that I could never achieve or find that love that I was looking for is exactly when Jesus showed me that He's the one that I'm looking for. Mm-hmm. That only He can satisfy the ache in my human heart. And it has nothing to do with necessarily how I look or, you know, or how I'm acting necessarily, but it's who I am, you know, and all of us are children of God in a sense.
That's right.
And we're all are children of God, and He wants mm-hmm. to satisfy that ache in our hearts.
Yeah. Your experience summed up the beautiful words, of St. Augustine, huh?
Yeah.
Who went through that himself, huh?
Yeah.
You know, trying to find love. He said, he wrote in his Confessions, God, you were with me, but I was not with you. And mm-hmm. the very things that should have led me to you were the very things that kept me from you, because he loved them for whatever they could benefit, give him as benefit. He didn't love them as stepping stones to God, because he should have seen God's loveliness in the things that God had made. And you know, and he penned those words in his confession, God, you have made our hearts for yourself. Yeah. They are ever restless till they rest in you. So your own experience has served you well, I think, Colin, to be working with young adults, because you were there and you can tell them, I know what it's like, I've been there, but I know what I found. And I can help you find the same thing, huh?
Yeah, it's amazing the conversations that I've gotten in with people about people either struggling with some type of body image or just struggling because they're single, especially, I'm working in New York City, so when I'm doing young adult outreach, I'm reaching out to 20s and 30-year-olds for Carnal Dolan, and there's a lot of single people there, and it's hard because like everyone's looking for their future spouse, and especially when you're getting a little older. I'm 31 and I'm still single, and it gets difficult because you feel like you're never gonna find that love that you're looking for. And it's such a good reminder to all of us, and with my encounter and my experience, is that, you know, our future spouse is not going to be the one that satisfies that ache. Only God can satisfy that ache. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's why I chose the what do you seek? It's one of my favorite stories in the gospel. You know, it's in the first book of John. You know, when John the Baptist he's kind of chilling with his disciples, and mm-hmm. Jesus walks by, and what does John the Baptist say? He says, points to Jesus, says, behold the Lamb of God. You know, basically saying to them, this is the one you're looking for. This is the future Messiah. Here's the satisfaction of our hearts, right? Mm-hmm. And of course, they didn't know him. And they were kind of a little nervous, and they approached Jesus. And then I just love the question that Jesus asked them. You know, he turned to them and he said, what do you seek? Mm-hmm. You know, in other words, what are you looking for?
Mm-hmm.
You know, they were a little anxious. I'm sure they didn't want to ask him, well, are you the Messiah? Are you the one I'm looking for? They were just like, they kind of went in a simpler way. Where are you staying? Like in the sense of, I want to get to know you. Who is this? Why did John the Baptist just say this? And what does Jesus say? He invites every single one of us, come and see. And then after spending that time with him, after they encountered the Christ, mm-hmm. then they experienced the satisfaction of their heart. So it's beautiful, and it's so important in our day and age to understand that, because we live in a culture that we're told that your future spouse. Now, marriage is one of the most beautiful sacraments. I'm not undermining anything about marriage, but we have to understand that only God can satisfy that ache in the human heart, and it's very important for the youth today.
That's right. I remember reading Bishop Sheen in his book on It Takes Three to Get Married, you know, and he says in there that one of the things that sets up many couples for disappointment in their marriages is that they marry thinking that the spouse they marry will be the total satisfaction of all their desire. Because it's impossible. A human being cannot satisfy, because the heart was made for the infinite, and only God is infinite, see? Yeah. And so that's can be a real difficulty that couples have to adjust to after they get married, is my husband or my wife is not the perfect person or the one that's going to satisfy everything in my life. I'm happy with my spouse. I love my spouse, and that's what it should be. A reflection of the love, St. Paul tells us, right, between the love of Christ and the church.
That's right.
But to be the perfect one, to satisfy every longing, only God can do that. And that's why, you know, it was a sad thing. I often mention this. But I was in Ireland some years ago and preaching in different towns. And as we were traveling from town to town, I was in a car with a couple of young people. And we went through this one town, and I'll never forget, they pointed out a bridge and they said, "You see that bridge over there? Last week, for 7 days in a row, a young man jumped off that bridge and took his life." And basically, all had the same reason. They had broken up with their girlfriends. And you know, like you were saying, like nothing else to live for. That's the one I'm seeking. This is the one that'll make me happy. But you know, we have to realize, no, it's deeper. That desire that was made by God, put there by God, you know? So, then you mentioned Our Lady, huh? Came into your life there. Very beautiful.
Yeah.
Doesn't she bring us so many
graces? She brings us so much, and later in the show we'll talk more about Our Lady, of how she's encountered. But you know, you brought up an interesting point in the sense of, like, our hearts have been created for the infinite, and you can't satisfy the infinite with finite things. So a lot of these youth and young adult, like that story you just, you know, shared, if we go into life and into our relationships thinking that finite things will satisfy the infinite, it's going to lead to despair. It's going to lead to, because it's like they're going to experience that they can't be satisfied by this. And then where else are they going to turn to? So one of my favorite parts of my job is that I'm able to bring Christ and bring Our Lady to these young adults in Manhattan, which is probably one of the darkest places in the world. I mean, Manhattan is the most populated, lonely place that I've ever seen, and I think in the world. And to be able to bring them, and you know what they're really looking for, is it's a dream job for me, and it's an important for all of us to realize this. You know.
Yeah, to lead them to Christ and. You know, just as those two disciples walking after Jesus, you know, where are you staying? And he said, come and see. Once you experience this, that Christ alone can give us, you know, your heart is fulfilled, and you want to share that. And that's exactly what, right, we know for sure St. Andrew went out and got his brother Peter, St. Peter, and brought him to Jesus, said, we found the Messiah. And I'm sure that's the other disciple, unnamed, but tradition says it was St. John, you know, the beloved disciple, who went out and got his brother James, you know, and they ended up being among the first disciples of our Lord, you know, followers. So there's something great happens when you find Jesus, you just want to share that. And it's kind of interesting how, you know, the Lord lets you go through your struggle. And even sometimes the secularism that touches our faith, so many people growing up today, they go off to, you know, in high school, some of it begins, later on in college, they drift away, and all of a sudden they realize how empty my life is, and we pray that they will certainly find their way back to God, and that's why your work is so very, very important. And I know you mentioned going to the canonization of Padre Pio.
Yeah.
Do you have a devotion to him personally?
You know, not as much as I should. I have a big devotion of St. Therese, Blessed Jacinta, St. Gemma Galgani, and as well as Padre Pio, but I just wish I had more of a relationship with him. But what I experienced over there at Padre Pio's canonization was beautiful. Being able to go to St. Michael's Cave and be able to go to the House of Loretta, it was quite an experience that God, you know, it comes down again to that encounter. It's like I was able to really experience what my heart was really looking for, you know, in a lot of ways.
you know, you appreciate a good meal when you've been hungry for a long time.
Exactly.
Right?
Our culture is starving.
That's it.
And we don't know what we're looking for.
Yeah. Well, Colin, I know we're going to have opportunity to tell them where they can find more. But we're going to have to take a break now.
Okay.
Please don't go away. We've got an awful lot to share with you. Welcome back to Sunday Night Prime. I'm Father Andrew Apostoli, your host for today's program, and our very special guest is Colin Nykaza, who's the Director of Young Adult Outreach for the Archdiocese of New York. Well, Colin, you shared with us your bit of your journey, and it brought you to finding the Lord and that peace. At least as much as we can experience in this life,
right?
That peace that God alone can give. Well, how did you get involved then into young adult ministry? What attracted you in some way?
Sure, that's a great question. So, you know, I've had a very interesting journey in the sense that, and it's been a very beautiful journey, painful at times, but, you know, all beautiful. I, you know, after I had that encounter with the Blessed Virgin Mary, I kind of felt her asking me to enter into the seminary. So I entered into the, I was studying for the Bridgeport Diocese in Connecticut. So I was in a minor seminary called St. John Fisher Seminary in Stamford, Connecticut, beautiful seminary. And I was there for 2.5 years. And then during that time, I was also considering religious life. So I spent some time in Rome considering, at the time, they were called the Brothers of Minor Mary Immaculate. Spent a couple summers with them there. And so with that experience, I mean, I had a lot of opportunities as a seminarian to work with youth and to work with young adults in all different various areas. Mm-hmm. And then I actually, after the first theology, I discerned that God was calling me out. So I left the seminary. And for 2 years, I lived in Philadelphia, and I worked for an organization called Generation Life. And so I started to give talks on pro-life issues and sexual morality and theology mm-hmm. of the body and chastity. So it was, you know, it was a beautiful time, and I was able to, work with tons of youth and young adult at that point mm-hmm. as well, you know, going into schools, giving talks, going around the country, giving talks. And then, you know, I felt God call me back into the seminary. So I went back in for another 3 years mm-hmm. and, you know, did that again. I went to Mount St. Mary's Seminary in Emmitsburg, Maryland, mm-hmm. which is the major seminary one of the major seminaries the diocese uses. And then, you know, it came to a point where, once again, you know, right before diaconate, you know, just with good spiritual direction, with my holy hours, and I discerned that Jesus and Our Lady were calling me out. So I left the seminary, and this was about 2 years ago. And to be honest, you know, I went to World Youth Day in Madrid, which was an awesome experience, and I was working with youth and young adult there. And then I went to, I was just driving people to airports from in Connecticut until I was able to get the position with what I have now. So basically I wanted to get into a family life office, and I was interviewing for the marriage prep or the natural family planning NFP coordinator position, which was in the diocese at the time.
But after is that New York?
Archdiocese, yeah.
Archdiocese, uh-huh.
And after the second interview, they were like, we don't want you for neither of these positions, but you obviously have a lot of experience with young adults and youth. How would you consider becoming the young adult director for the Archdiocese in New York? And I was like, absolutely, sure. So they hired me shortly after that.
Wonderful.
And I've been there for about almost 2 years now.
So, 2 years, okay. No. Yeah, I'm sure it's a great challenge, you know, because, again, you're doing wonderful work. But when you know, when you have, as the gospel would say, you find that treasure hidden in the field.
Yeah.
You stumble over it sometimes. Sometimes you're looking for it like the pearl of great price that you go looking. You know there's something I'm made for. There's something for me. Mm. I don't always know what it is until I find Christ.
Yeah.
And then I find that treasure. Did you find that you had a sense of wanting to share that? What you had found?
Absolutely.
Others.
I mean, it's amazing. I mean, when I left the seminary, if Jesus appeared to me and sat me down and like put a piece of paper and pen down and says, Kyle, write out your job and you can do it, I couldn't have dreamt or written anything better than I'm experiencing now. My whole journey, what I've been through and my whole journey in the seminary, it's amazing how I'm able to use it in the ministry that I'm doing now with young adults. Mm-hmm. You know, as I can relate to them on so many different levels, and you know, every heart's different, but every heart goes through similar situations. And so I'm, you know, I just feel really blessed to be able to be an instrument for God and Our Lady to help lead young adults to really what they're looking for and to help them through their difficult times, you know, mm-hmm. especially here in New York City. I mean, New York City is it's a very difficult place to be in yeah. a lot of ways. It's fun. It's great. It's a good time to be there, you know, and a good time of my life to be there. But at the same time, there's a lot of, you know, a lot against you there, a lot of temptation.
Yes. Yes. We're certainly fighting. We're in the middle of the struggle.
Yeah.
You know, we can't deny that, you know. But it is, it's wonderful to hear you say, you know, how you love what you're doing. I know sometimes I think about my life as a religious and a Franciscan friar of the renewal, and my life as a priest, and you know, I just thank God. I feel in my own heart. I couldn't desire to be anything else. I really love what God has called me to, and it's so good to hear you say that. You know, you feel, you know, that in your heart that you're doing something. So that you want to do with all your heart.
Yeah,
that's one of the best. I think ingredients for someone who's working in a ministry like yours. You know, you can teach a lot of things, you know, in theory we give this and that. But you know, the thing, the spark that makes the difference is, I want to do this.
Yeah.
I want to do this with all my heart. I believe in it.
Yeah.
And so I'm going to give it my all.
Yeah.
You know, I remember seeing a poster one time and said, one person with a belief is equal in force to 99 people who merely have an interest, you know? So you believe in what you're doing, and that's so important. Any activities that you'd like to share that you've had?
Yeah, we are really excited. We're gonna have quite a year. So, I mean, Cardinal Dolan, you know, who I'm working for, is so, he's amazing. And he's so, and he's very focused on the youth and young adult. You know, we hear a lot that like youth and young adult are like the future church. But I think we're starting to realize that we are not necessarily we are, of course, the future youth, but we are the church. Mm-hmm. And then we really need to be reached out to. And Cardinal Dolan really recognizes this. He recognizes the hunger in all of our hearts. So we're blessed. We're about to actually really expand and blow up our program for the Archdiocese of New York. Like right now, it's just myself as the, and a director is an in-house term. You know, I'm not out there going to young adult groups telling them what to do or how to do things. This, I look at my position, and this position really is an act of service.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, structurally what we're doing is that the Archdiocese of New York is very big. It's huge. Like, just working in Manhattan itself is almost 2 full-time jobs with all the activities that are going on there, which I'll talk more about.
Mm-hmm.
But it goes for another 3 to 4 hours north and wide, and so it's huge. So we're actually splitting the whole diocese into 3 regions.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, Region 1 is going to be Manhattan and Staten Island, and I'll do a lot of the hands-on outreach myself there. And then we'll have Region 2, which is going to be the upper counties, like Ulster County, Sullivan County, Orange County, up there. And we're going to actually hire a full-time coordinator to be able to reach out there and do young adult activity. Then we're going to have Region 3, which is going to be the mid-counties, like Yonkers, Bronx, South Shore, those areas. And we're going to have a full-time coordinator reaching out there. And then we're going to have 2 full-time Hispanic coordinators, which we're really excited about.
Mm-hmm.
Because another demographic that's very, very huge in the Archdiocese of New York, and it's so important to keep it, to reach out to really everyone, but you know, especially that demographic. So we're really excited about that. And with that, we're going to have a new website. We're going to have, right now we have catholicnyc.com. And we're going to have, but we're revamping the website. But so a lot of my job is basically, I have a huge email list, so I send out an email about once a week of a lot of the different young adult activities that are happening throughout the whole Archdiocese. So the Theology on Taps that are happening in the city, the Catholic Undergrounds, the speakers coming in, the concerts, the musicians coming in from all over the country. So a lot of my job is helping advertise those things, and at the same time kind of going to a lot of these events and just showing support and showing that because you know, when I go to these things, I'm just representing Cardinal Dolan and really reaching out, recognizing that the diocese cares for you, Cardinal Dolan cares for you, I care for you, and we're here to support you.
Mm-hmm.
It's like I got the best job in the world. I mean, my job is literally just hanging out with young adults. So it's everywhere, anything from, you know, somebody moves into New York City or somewhere in the diocese and is looking for a young adult group or something to do, I'll meet with them one-on-one, and I'll be able to hook them up with, like, you know, if a musician moves in. I know a ton of musicians now because of the job, and I can kind of get them to a certain crowd. Or if an actor moves in, I can be like, oh, you know, the Actors Chapel at St. Malachy's has an awesome young adult group. go check them out. Mm-hmm. So a lot of it's a lot of my job, social networking. To as far as you know, the movie The Butler and Les Mis and were considered in a sense Christian movies, in the sense of Christian themes, not necessarily Christian movies, but the good solid themes. Yeah. So they'll invite me to their. I was blessed to go to the movie premiere of The Butler, and because they want me to advertise the movie, so being able to kind of help in that type of crowd as well. So that's a lot of stuff's coming for the young adult outreach here for the diocese.
This is great. Yeah. Well, we need to be reaching out to them, because they used to say that after grammar school, particularly I remember years ago after confirmation, a lot of the religious instruction, CCD and all, kind of faltered because there wasn't a lot of developed programs for high school. There were, but they were sort of maybe very limited.
Yeah.
The great emphasis, of course, was the younger children up to confirmation age and mm-hmm. end of grammar school. You know, but there was always that big jump from grammar school to high school, and if they were not in a religious school, Catholic school, they might end up not having any contact mm-hmm. with their parish. So it's so good to see. That the Spirit is really moving mm-hmm. the church to reach out to this segment of our population in the church. Yeah. They're young people. They've got a lot of energy. They've got a lot of enthusiasm.
They do.
Once you get them committed, they're going to do a great, great deal. And you mentioned some of these events, too, that are coming up to
And we have once a month we do a young adult mass. So we have at 7:30 p.m. at St. Patrick's Cathedral, we invite young adults from all over the diocese.
When is that? What day?
It's usually the first Wednesday of the month. Mm-hmm. We're switching the dates. I think we're going to try to start moving into the second Wednesdays of the month. But mm-hmm. If anybody was ever interested, they could just go on our website.
Yeah, what is that website again?
CatholicNYC.com. Okay. CatholicNYC.com. And we have a calendar, and you'll see all the different events that are coming up. And if they were ever interested, anybody was ever interested in getting on the email list, because once a week I blast out all the young adult activity that's happening for the whole Archdiocese of New York.
That's good.
And I'd also love to share with you briefly, Cardinal Dolan did the young adult mass on June 5th mm-hmm. of this past summer.
Wasn't that great to see Cardinal Dolan? He has really a great way to communicate with young people. You can see his enthusiasm, and you see how they respond to him.
Yeah.
Is there anything you'd like to add to that?
It was an amazing experience. We had about 1,200 young adults show up for the young adult mass, so the cathedral was just packed. Cardinal Dolan was just so happy to see everything. His homily was awesome. He was just on fire. Preaching to everybody, and afterwards was kind of cool too. We had the Catholic guy from Sirius Radio kind of interview with Cardinal Dolan with about 30 or so young adults afterwards after the mass. So that was just exciting, for a lot of the young adults, just to be able to spend time and be able to question, Cardinal Dolan. They were asking mm-hmm. him all sorts of questions, what's your favorite music and above and beyond. And then afterwards we went to Connolly's, in the city, and were able to have a party too.
A little celebration, yeah. Okay, well, that's wonderful. Well, that's a great note. We're going to have to end this segment of the program, but please don't go away. We've got an awful lot more very interesting things we're going to touch on in our final segment tonight. Welcome back to Sunday Night Prime. I'm Father Andrew Apostoli, your host for tonight's wonderful program. And our very special guest tonight is Colin Nykaza, who is the Director of Young Adult Outreach for the Archdiocese of New York. Our program is entitled, What Do You Seek? The Journey of a Restless Heart. Well, I'm sure, Colin, you have many challenges in your work, but what do you see as the vision for the young adult ministry?
Sure, that's a good question. Mainly is that, Mother Teresa, actually just praying with her kind of helped me see things clear. First of all, first thing I really want to make sure is happening is that, Cardinal Dolan has a great vision and has a lot to offer the young adults. So I want to make sure that I'm implementing what what Cardinal Dolan wants and what the Chancellor wants. And so that involves various activities and things like, for example, Cardinal Dolan is looking for more adoration and confessions during the Masses. So we're implementing all that type of activity. As an overall arching theme, there's like two main things that I try to do. One, you know, Mother Teresa talks about how we can't convert people. You know, only God can convert people.
That's right.
But we can put people in opportunities to encounter Christ and be converted. So my first main goal is to set up opportunities for young adults, 20s and 30s, to encounter Christ. And that's in all various levels. That's through the sacraments, so we have the young adult mass. That's through confession, so we have the confessions through the mass, as I was talking about, in a sense, with that Cardinal Dolan, through adoration, through prayer, and things like that. Now, the thing is that not, you know, and these are people who are going to mass and people who are going to confession and adoration probably have already kind of encountered the Lord, or they've had something to lead them toward those moments. And that's not everybody, you know? So, sure. And I'm really focused on that, understanding that, you know, we're all at different levels, you know, as especially in young adults. We're going to be setting up these committees, you know, throughout the Archdiocese too. For example, we're going to have like a volunteer committee, a sports committee, an arts committee, and there's about like 7 or 8 more. And the idea is to maximize the outreach in all different levels, to really reach out to everybody's particular tastes, especially in Manhattan. There's so many different walks of life there and professions. I mean, actors, athletes, you know, accounting, everything, right? Lawyers, it's everywhere. So we want to make sure we're reaching out to everybody. You know, so not everybody's necessarily going to go to a mass or adoration, but I think a lot of, especially one crowd will definitely go to a softball game or a volleyball game or, and soccer. And so the idea of like the sports committee is to set up to get other, you know, Catholics and Christians playing together and inviting whoever else wants to play and get involved. And because the cool thing is that, you know, sometimes people who, if they haven't hung out much with Catholics or, you know, Christians, they kind of look like they were kind of weird or just kind of awkward, or there's something maybe just a little off about us. And then we have them come play, you know, the sports with us, and they'll be, you know, like, all right, so this guy is pretty normal. He seems pretty down to earth, you know? And it's like, and then we'll have that chance to be like, oh, hey, you know, why don't you come out to, come to the Young Adult Mass one of these days? So a lot of that stuff's coming. The second main goal I have is, in kind of going with what I just said, is that not only have that personal encounter with Christ, but I want other young adults to know that they're not alone in the city. As I said, you know, Manhattan, in a lot of the parts, Archdiocese of New York, is one of the most populated, lonely places in the world. And I want to make sure that young adults have opportunities to meet like-minded young adults who share their faith, who share their values and their morals. So we have the Young Adult Mass with the socials afterwards. We have the Catholic Undergrounds. We have the Theology on Taps. And the beautiful thing about my position is that I'm not necessarily putting all these on myself. There are so many leaders in New York City in the Archdiocese who are putting on the events themselves, and I'm helping them just advertise and get the word out there. You know, one of the most beautiful things about my job is that there's so many good people there really actively reaching out to young adults in the community. I'm able to kind of bring them all together and help them the best I can. So those are the two main things: personal encounter with Christ and encounter with each other. And that goes across all different areas.
That's wonderful. You have the major ingredients for the journey that you're talking about, you know, the journey of a restless heart.
Yeah.
You know, I like the idea, you know, having like sports to get people who might not come to the church. We see that as our problem today. You know, even Pope Francis has said, you know, to priests and religious, get out of your rectories, get out of your religious houses and get out to the people on the street, because the people are not coming into the churches.
Yeah.
We've got to meet them where they are.
You're right.
And like you said, someone who might not be attracted to go and spend an hour before the Blessed Sacrament because they're struggling whether they believe that Christ is in the Eucharist to begin with,
right,
might be much more attracted to come to play a little softball game or a little social pizza or something like that. And all of a sudden, as they're discussing, they find somebody who does believe in the Eucharist and who can share, you know, it's changed my life. Just try it, you know. And that's a great thing. You know, you would never, I would not have thought all these different ways that could be welcoming to young people. And that's what we need to do. We've got to be able to get them to approach us, or at least come to know who we are.
Yeah.
You know, just recently, some of our young brothers started a door-to-door ministry, going to knocking on people's doors, introducing themselves.
That's awesome.
You know, some of the people thought it was Jehovah's Witnesses, but it happened to be, you know, some Catholic brothers who were, you know, just inviting them to the church or finding out if they have any religious needs that,
That's great.
Could be met. So you got to go out and meet them where they are. So
you know, and here in America, it's like we're a mission church here. It's like we don't have to go to the ends of the world to be missionaries. We can do right in our neighborhoods.
That's right. Yes, we have become, as Pope Benedict, with the whole thrust of the new evangelization, has told us that those countries that, you know, once were very strong in the faith, in the last 100 years or 50 years, of certainly, you know, Catholic identity has certainly changed.
Yeah.
Years ago, you could more clearly identify who was a Catholic. I was born, you'd go to Mass on Sunday, probably confession on Saturday, you ate fish on Friday, you went to a novena sometime during the week, or different things, activities, said your rosary. But today, so much of that has become almost anonymous. You know, so many Catholics just don't have that sense, and we need to draw them. We need to draw them.
Absolutely,
and there's so much we have to give, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, what are I know we talked a lot, Colin, about some of the specific areas of challenge.
Yeah.
You think we should hit some of those and
see? Yeah, you know, it comes down to one of the biggest challenges I have is that to keep young adults going to the event continually, or to have that encounter. You know, it's like, you know, people, we have an influx of population in the sense of like different crowds coming in. And so we're trying to figure out how we can, you know, make, you know, help, you know, get at least these young adults in an opportunity to encounter that encounter with Christ. And it doesn't happen overnight for people, of course, you know, so it's like, you know, it's not a magic trick. It's like any other type of relationship. You know, in order to get to know somebody, we need to spend time with somebody, right? You can't walk up down the street and walk up to somebody and be like, hey, you want to be my best friend? The guy would look at you like you're insane. So I'm very aware of that, in the sense that, like, you know, I trust Christ, and Christ I know is doing his thing, and I know that he's converting hearts much more than I can even possibly imagine every time someone's at Mass or at adoration. But at the same time, I want to make sure there's opportunities to draw them back to it, you know, in the sense of, like, with Christ's grace at the same time, but also making it attractive on other levels, in the sense of bringing them back. So it's very challenging. And to be honest, one of the most constant conversation I get into is the ache that I kind of talk about, in the sense of, and that's why I kind of wanted to have the theme of this ache. And, you know, it just kind of like, you know, why I shared that whole beginning within the story in the beginning was that basically kind of, I just had this encounter of, you know, just because of what I was experiencing from early on, is that depending on how this is how I thought it was, and I was wrong, and the guy showed me, but depending on how I looked was how I was going to be able to satisfy that ache in my heart. And it was at that very moment where I thought that I was unlovable and didn't look that great. And that's exactly when Christ came in. And I realized that it wasn't so much, even when I thought that I was not, you know, attractive in the sense, it wasn't because of how I looked, it was because how I thought about myself. I was very down on myself, so it changed my attitude. It changed the way that I approached people. It changed so that was what, you know, I think a lot of the problem was, is that I was very down on myself. And I just meet so many young adults who are just, you know, struggling with that ache, or, you know, who are down on themselves, and they don't feel comfortable within their own skin, or they don't feel like they're being successful, or they're doing the job they want to do. I mean, it goes on all different levels.
Yeah.
So it's challenging to be able to help them get the help that they need, and to set up opportunities to help them experience Christ, and let them see how Christ looks at them and how Our Lady looks at them.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we knew, I mean, each and every single one of us, Father, you know, we are unique, unrepeatable. Each one of us hold this beautiful, amazing gift of showing us something about God's life and love that only we can reveal. Like, if you don't share the gift of yourself with the world, Father, you are literally depriving the world of something awesome.
That's right.
And that goes for every single one of us.
Even giving it to God.
That's right.
If you don't give your love to God,
absolutely,
God is missing something.
Yeah.
Yeah, and well, you know, it's so important for anyone. If we're going to love other people, we first have to be able to love ourselves. And the first step of loving yourself is to accept yourself.
Yeah.
This is who I am, and then just to be who you are. You don't have to go around pleasing the whole world.
Right.
And then, you know, when you reach that point, you can really begin to listen to God's love for you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and know well, God loves me.
Yeah.
And once you come to that conclusion, God loves me, I know I'm lovable.
Right.
You know, even St. Augustine, even St. Paul, remember, he said, God loved me, and he loved me when I was least worthy of it.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah. Always remember that. Yeah. We don't have to dazzle God with our footwork, or we don't have to,
right,
you
and,
know.
And we think we ache. I mean, how Christ aches for us. Mother Teresa talks a lot about that, I thirst from the cross.
Right.
He's thirsting for our love as a unique individual, mm-hmm. not as humanity as a whole, mm-hmm. but as in every single individual. Right. And it's so important to know that.
You don't have to be perfect. You don't
no.
have to do the greatest things in the world.
Right.
Just give him your love.
Yeah.
And he is, as you say, he's thirsting for that. He's aching for that. God has an ache in his heart.
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting? Huh?
And Our Lady has really showed me this a lot, you know, mm-hmm. in the sense of, you know, it's beautiful in the sense of having this relationship and in encounter with the Blessed mm-hmm. Virgin Mary. I recommend if everybody to, you know, again, how you get to know someone, spend time with them, you know. So I try to spend a lot of time as much as I can with Our Lady. And she is just beautiful, like, and Father, you know, in the sense of just through, like, I always recommend, like, to people, it's a difficult consecration, but the consecration to Our Lady through St. Louis de Montfort and St. Maximilian Kolbe, because I just mm-hmm. share a few couple stories in my own life in the sense of Our Lady really takes care of you. She is our mother.
Absolutely.
You know, she, you know, for example, so if you do a consecration to Our Lady, that means that you're giving her permission to have all of your possessions, you know? And so, you know, so that means everything, like everything that I own, like my clothes, my bed, my room, the money in my account, it's Our Lady's. Like I give her permission to do with it, you know, whatever she wants to do with it. And, you know, it kind of hit home, and I experienced this when I was entering the seminary the second time, when I mentioned that I left and went back in.
Mm-hmm.
And I had to get rid of all my stuff because I had a queen size bed, I had all this stuff, and my bed, I wasn't able to sell my bed. And the day I'm leaving for the seminary, I still was not able to sell my bed. And I just threw my hands up to Our Lady, be like, look, Blessed Virgin Mary, it's your bed. Like, I can't take it with me to the seminary, so you got to figure something out. The guy who was actually helping me move ended up buying the bed. He liked it. He liked the way it looked at me. And he bought it. And it's just like, she always takes care of you and that type of stuff, you know?
Yeah, never was it heard. Remember the memorari. Never was it heard that anyone who fled to your protection, implored your help, or sought your intercession, was left unaided.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's one. That's a great story, Colin. Yeah, thank you for sharing that. And you know, she also helps us to know that we are lovable.
Oh, yeah.
And once you experience that, you want to go out and do so much more for other people, because, you know, you see people who are broken and you realize, you know, I was at that spot and I owe it to my brother, my sister, my sister and brother in Christ to do something for them, you know, to help them on their journey, you know. And I know a lot of the, you know, today, many of the areas of challenge, what do you see, you know, if you can make sharing with the young people here today, who would be watching this program, and all the people watching it too, the young and the young at heart. What would be some of the areas you would express to them of great concern and where they can find that help, you know?
First, you know, our society is very, obviously extremely secular, and it's filled with noise. You know, it's like, it's very difficult to hear God within your heart and to find God with all the distractions. I mean, it's distraction. Yeah. We've got the iPhones, the iPads, the, you know, the new TVs, the new laptops, everything coming out. And, you know, and it's really easy from early on. I mean, I'm going to give talks to like 6th, 7th graders, and it's unbelievable. All of them have smartphones, and they're sitting there, you know, playing on their smartphones, and it's like, it's a complete generation that I grew up in. And it's easy to get lost in entertainment. It's easy to get lost in that. So one challenge I'd recommend to people is, these are not bad things in themselves. I have an iPhone. Mm. It's completely helpful, extremely helpful for me for my work. But to be able to put down that for a little time during the day and kind of really to start, you know, put together some type of, or aside for some type of prayer, even if it's like 10 minutes a day, if you can go to a church, or if you can just sit in your room and just allow, and just be this and be silent, mm-hmm. you know, and just allow Christ to talk to you and allow Our Lady to, because that's the key to what you were talking about, how, especially with Our Lady, how she showed me her love for me, not only taking care of my everyday little needs, but just the way that she looks at me within my own heart, the way that Christ looks at me in my own heart. But I can't discover that unless I give them the time to be able to do it. Because mm-hmm. they're thirsting for free love just like anybody else.
Sure, you know? Sure, yeah.
And they're not going to force us to do it. So we got to set that time to do it, you know?
That's right. Yeah, because you can't hear God speaking to you
yeah.
if you've got 50 other voices coming in at you.
Yeah.
You know, divergent and often conflicting, very, very conflicting messages too.
Huh? Absolutely.
You know, that's a great thing to start off with here, to really ask young people to take time to think. Think about life. Think about where you're going. What direction
yeah.
am I heading in, you know? Any other areas? I know we had talked a little bit about, some of the...
If I could, I mean, I'll, you know, end with this, just a brief story of a friend of mine who actually had a death experience. He's now a priest in the Bridgeport Diocese in Connecticut. But basically, you know, and it just kind of ties into like how only God can satisfy that ache. My buddy lived in Fairfield, Connecticut, and he was struggling with different addictions. He was struggling with drugs and alcohol, and he was kind of in Fairfield. There was one time that him and his buddy went for a swim in a nearby lake. One of his buddies took down a fifth of Jack Daniels, never came back. Ooh. Another one of his friends got in a car accident and was killed. He realized he was trying to get out of that scene, so he moved down to Florida. And he wasn't able to break his addictions. It got so bad to a point where he was actually selling his blood at a nearby, selling his blood to be able to buy his next fix. And when he was doing that, because of the addiction he was going through, his body was so messed up, he clinically died on the table for 3 to 5 seconds. And this is what he said happened. He said he found himself all of a sudden in like this black abyss. And he said two things were infused into his mind. He says he knew he was dead and he knew there was a God. And he saw this beautiful light around the horizon. And he says he knew it was heaven and he longed to go there, but he knew he didn't choose it. And he said he saw this creature kind of walking along the wall. And he says as soon as he saw, he was trying to check out the creature, all of a sudden he saw his guardian angel, he said, right in front of him. He saw his beautiful guardian angel. And he said he looked into his eyes. And he says as soon as he looked into his eyes, he said he lived his own personal judgment. He says everything that he did, every time he didn't follow his conscience, every time he chose, you know, evil over good, or vice versa, you know, like, and he realized that he lived his personal judgment. He realized that he chose to go to hell, that God didn't condemn him to hell. He chose it. And he says, right when he was about to jump in, he says he found himself on top of the earth with his guardian angel. And he said, all of a sudden, he said he knew it was Christ behind him, and he felt this penetrating of life and love being poured through his body. And he said everything he was ever looking for in drugs and sex and sex outside of marriage and alcohol and a lot of the stuff he was doing was being ultimately satisfied in this experience of the encounter with Christ. And he heard these words. He heard, Jeff, I love you. Jeff, I love you. Now go to unto others as I have done unto you. And he got thrown back into his body and he woke up. And it was such a powerful encounter with him because he says, you know, and he always asked me to share it at the end of when I give talks because he said, this is like everything you've talked about. You know, we're not everything I experienced. The church teaches this, that only Christ can satisfy the ache of the human heart. That's and right. It's real. And we're not, this is not just like an imaginary thing. Mm-hmm. And we've got to encounter it. And he had a very powerful encounter
sure.
with that.
Sure, you know, people, God in many ways breaks into their lives just when they think they're most comfortable.
Yeah.
And he sometimes pulls the rug out from under them. And, you know, it's a wake-up call.
Yeah.
On the Lord, I remember reading a meditation years ago, and it said that sometimes to get our attention, God turns our world upside down. And that meditation was in a little prayer booklet. For the day after 9/11, and I said, as I read that, I said, you know, God did that just yesterday for a lot of people. But we want to pray that our young people will hear, you know, God's call and their journey, that ache you talked about so well.
And if anybody ever wanted to contact me or give a talk on sexual morality or anything like that, you can just go to ctnykaza@gmail.com and email me.
Okay.
And any, you know, if anybody had ever wanted to.
Well, wonderful, Colin. I thank you so much for being a guest on the program today. Well, unfortunately, all good things in this world come to an end now, but so we're going to have to end our program. But
thanks so much for having me.
We may God bless your work and all the wonderful things that you're doing for young people. Let's say a little prayer as we close in a blessing. In the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord Jesus, you sent your disciples out to proclaim the gospel to all people. And we ask you to bless the work of Colin and those who work with him and work with the youth to bring the gospel message to them and eternal life. And I bless all of you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, Colin, we come to that part of the program now where we do a little appeal for funds. You know, this wonderful program that you've seen now today and working with the youth, the What Do You Seek? The Journey of a Restless Heart is an important message for a lot of people, especially young people, because, you know, we know they're under pressure. Many of them feel when they run into difficulties, some of them think to escape by, unfortunately, extremes like maybe drugs and alcohol, but sometimes taking their lives. Yeah. They need to hear a positive message, a message of hope. God loves them and that there's an answer to that ache in their heart. How could they do it unless you had like EWTN sending that message out? So please support EWTN as generously as you can with your prayers and your financial donations. God will bless you for that. And God bless you all. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.